come to the presence of God. And when we appear, we give ourselves. You know, you surrender your mind to Him. You surrender your soul to Him. You surrender your body to Him. And the Bible is saying that that is the reasonable and acceptable worship unto God. The person that is already donated to God. That God, if I am here as you see me, there is no part of me that is not here. Every part of me is in your presence and I am worshiping you. The Bible says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and everything that makes me. Let it be able to give you glory. Everything about me. Hallelujah. Everything about me. So when you appear in the presence of the Lord, the first thing that you need to do, even before you give God some worship, even before you give God your offerings, or anything else, it is to make sure that you are sanctified. It is to make sure that what you are going to do that day in the presence of God shall be acceptable. And it can never be acceptable until you yourself, you are acceptable before the Lord. The reason why God did not receive the offering of Ananias and Sapphira is because as they appeared in the presence of the Lord, they had not given themselves to God. They had already purposed to lie in the presence of God. They lied before they came from home. And they conspired and they agreed and they arranged it and they agreed, you, Ananias, go first. Enda utoshanishe Peter. Na mimi nikikuja nikuweka muhuri kile ambacho unasema. Their hearts were not right before God. They thought like service was about what they are giving. They forgot that God was interested with their hearts more than what they gave Him. They forgot that God saw beyond what they were giving in their hands to where it was coming from the heart. That from the time they came from home, they had purpose that they are going to shortchange God. From the time they came from their home, they did not come to worship. They came to display some kind of arrogance before the servant of God. And when Peter looked at Ananias and he asked him, is this all that you have sold? He said, yes. And that is why I put it under your feet. The heart was not right. The condition of their spirit was not acceptable before the Almighty God. And because of that, the Lord rejected their offering. Because of that, the Lord rejected their giving. The Lord rejected their worship. You see, the word that carries worship, the same word is the same word that offering is interpreted. So the time when you are offering unto God, we are continuing to worship God. Matoleo yako ni ibada mbele za Bwana. Lakini leo ninataka tuelewane ya kwamba ibada yako inakubalika mbele za Bwana kutokana na moyo wako vile uko mbele za Bwana. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. When I look at Judas and look at Peter, I consider Peter to have done a more grievous sin than Judas. And the reason is that Peter denied Jesus. Denied him. Jesus looked at him and he was there and Peter was here. And he said, I don't know him. And not once, not twice, thrice, he denied Jesus. He said, this man, I have never seen him. And I already looked at him. And he told him, even your accent shows or agrees that you are a Galilean, just like this man. And he looked at this woman and he said, you woman, I don't know that man. How many times will I tell you, I have never met him. I have never seen him. I don't know him. And Jesus is in his worst time of persecution. He is monitoring the people that followed him daily. He is watching how the people that he fed every day, how the people that he healed every day, how the people that he stood for every day deny him. And then the Bible says the cock crowed. But when it crowed, the Bible says Peter was, the heart was grieved. And he went before the Lord and he repented before the Lord. And the Lord accepted him. After that denial, he went and he cried bitterly before the Lord. And the Lord accepted him. He did not only accept him, but he made him the pillar of the church. He did not only accept Peter, but he anointed him. He was the one that championed, you know, the move of the Spirit in the day of the Pentecost. He was amongst the first people that received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. But Judas, you know, every day he stole from the treasury. And he thought like Jesus did not see. I guess sometimes he would look at people and he said, this Jesus, you think like he is prophetic. You think like he sees. If he knew how much I stole yesterday, he would not be allowing me to handle this treasure. But this man, I guess, his ministry, ikonakasoro, because he can see from outside. He can see when he's ministering to people, but he cannot see what is happening within his heart. He never knew that God or Jesus had given him the opportunity to repent. And even when he sold Jesus and he betrayed Jesus, the Bible says when he realized that he has betrayed an innocent man, he did not go to Jesus to repent. He went to the high priest. And he went to people that were not spiritual. And he told them, I have realized that I have sinned against an innocent man. And he took the money that he was given, he was paid to betray Jesus. And he told them, get back your money. Then they told him, no. We can never take that money. That money, in fact, the fact that you have said now he is an innocent man, that is what will make us not even to be associated with that money. And the Bible says that they told him, go back with your money. And this man did not see any point. He did not have fruits of repentance. Because he went ahead, he bought a land, he went ahead, drew money somewhere in an open field, and he went and committed suicide. He could not offer himself unto God. He could not come to God in a brokenness of heart. He could not come back to God in a brokenness of a spirit. He could not understand the principles of repentance and sanctification. He had walked with Jesus and he had seen Jesus healing lepers by forgiving their sins. He had walked with Jesus and he had seen the woman that broke the alabaster box before Jesus. And even though she was a sinner, Jesus accepted her offering because of the condition of the heart that this woman had. Hallelujah. Amen. This Judas had walked with Jesus when a woman was brought that was caught in adultery before the Lord. And they told him that according to the law of Moses, it was stated that this person should die by stoning. And they asked Jesus, what should be done unto this woman? And Jesus looked at them and he told them, if any one of you has no sin, let him be the first one to cast a stone. That is to say now, as the Lord, I am not here to condemn people. I am here to help them, you know, live a righteous life. I am here to help them in the process of sanctification. Amen. Hallelujah. And every person left. The woman was not strong, and the disciples were looking. And he looked at the woman, and he told her, neither do I condemn you. Go in peace and sin no more. So Judas had classic examples where Jesus forgave people that sinned even more than he had done, that had committed worse offenses and sins than he had done. But God forgave them. But this Judas did not come into time with a revelation of forgiveness. Hallelujah. Amen. And that is why he missed it. Because he did not have a surrendered soul unto the Lord. Judas did not have surrendered soul unto the Lord. How many of us have been walking with God, but we have never given ourselves unto him? How many of us have been working for God, but we have never given ourselves unto God? We have never surrendered our all unto God, our spirit, our bodies, our everything unto God. Let me tell you something. If you give yourself unto God, every other giving will not be a struggle in your life. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. If you allow God to own you, if you give yourself fully unto the Lord, if you dedicate yourself to God, if you offer yourself as a living sacrifice before the Lord, there is nothing else that will matter in your life. The reason why the world matters to us is because as a church and as believers, we have given ourselves unto the Lord a halfway. And we have left the half to be in the world. And the Bible says, did you know that your love with the world is it is enmity with God? Every time we are in love with the world, the Bible says we become enemies with God. And the reason is, you can never serve two masters. So if you have decided to walk with the Lord, my friend, today I came to tell you, give yourself fully unto the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Offer yourself unto God. Surrender yourself unto God. Because there is nothing greater unto God than your soul. There is nothing greater that you can give to God than your body. There is nothing greater that you can give to God than your spirit. God is looking for you. He's looking for your spirit. He's looking for your body that he may use it on the face of the earth. He wants people that are surrendered to him. Before you raise your hands unto the Lord and offer a worship before God, make sure that your heart is right with him. Take time and align yourself, your spirit, your soul, and your body unto the Lord. Take time and offer yourself to him so that everything now that will come out of there, out of your body, it will be acceptable. The Bible call it a reasonable and acceptable way of worship. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let us not treat the presence of God casually. Let us not treat the Christian walk casually. The Bible says, he that must follow me, number one, they must take their cross and carry it. So the life of Christianity and following Jesus is a life of sacrifice daily. It's a life of daily sacrifice. Hallelujah.
Amen.
As we walk with God, every day we are carrying our cross. It is a life of perpetually, you know, living for God with every fiber of your being. Usiokoke roho na mwili wako haujakombolewa. Usiokoke nafsi na kinywa chako akijakombolewa. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. That every time you are in the presence of God and you are raising your hand before the Lord, everybody will see an angel in you. But when we find you in the place where you stay, we find like you are different altogether, another person. That is not the kind of Christianity that God is looking for. He is looking for people that have surrendered themselves unto God. He is looking at, you know, for people that have offered themselves fully unto Him. If we are going to experience God, then we must give ourselves totally to Him. Totally. Let me tell you, God is not a God that will take another position in your life if it is not number one. If you have offered yourself, not fully, but a part of you unto God, I want you to know that that part you are offered unto God, it is not acceptable before Him. God wants all of you. Hallelujah. Amen. When He died on the cross, He sanctified you. He sanctified your walk. He sanctified your words. He sanctified your mind. And that is why He wants every part of you. He wants you to walk with Him. He wants you to know Him. He wants you to, you know, comprehend Him fully. Praise the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Offer yourself as a living sacrifice. So every time you're walking, know that you are godly sacrifice that is living. You have offered yourself. Every time you are talking, know that you are a living sacrifice that is already offered unto the Lord. Every time you are ministering to God, come as a living sacrifice before the Lord. Be acceptable because you have offered yourself. Your words shall be acceptable. Your worship shall be acceptable. Your other givings shall be acceptable before the Lord. But the foundation of every giving begins with you as you give your heart unto the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus.
Amen.
It begins with you as you give your heart to the Lord. I want you to look at this just small picture. I want to paint before you. The Lord Jesus found Petro and the man is fishing. He found Matthew, a mathematician and a tax collector. And He tells them, follow me. And that man that day forsake everything, the career, the ambitions, and the pursuit of their life, and they follow Jesus. That is what God wants us to do. And they do not look behind. Elisha followed Elijah, and to make sure that he will never look behind, he went and took the oxen. The Bible says they were 12. And he slew the animals and he sacrificed them before the Lord. And he told Elijah, now I have burned every bridge that can connect me to my former life. The disciples of Jesus, mature men with families, the Bible says they followed Jesus. He told them, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. And they left their careers, their professions, their businesses, and they followed Him without being mindful of how I will educate my children, how my family will eat, without being mindful of how my life will look like. They just gave themselves as a living sacrifice before the Lord. That is why God accepted them. That is why they were relevant in their generation. That is why God used, the Bible says, illiterate men and ignorant men to turn the world upside down. Because they were surrendered and they had surrendered everything of their lives unto God. Let me tell you, dead men are the only people that can see God. If you have not come into a place whereby you yourself have offered yourself before the Lord as a living sacrifice, there are dimensions of God that will not see. There are dimensions of His power. There are dimensions of His grace. There are dimensions of the miraculous that you will never see until you offer yourself as a living sacrifice. God appeared before Abraham. He told him, leave your father's house. Leave your kitchen, leave your nation, and go to the land that I will show you. From today, I want you to donate your life to me. And I want to use you to raise a godly nation on the face of the earth. And the man accepted and followed God. The problem with us is that none of us that has died to themselves. That is why the life of God, it is not at work in our life. Because we kept our life and we want the life of God. We kept our lives, we kept our reputations, we kept, you know, our fame. We want to be famous, we want to be superstars, we want to be popular. And with that, we want Jesus to manifest in our lives. And he will tell you, no, I can't mix those two. I can never mix them. The problem that God is having with our generation is people that are diverting his glory. Is people that have never sown themselves as a seed in the kingdom, such that every harvest that comes from that seed, it will be all about God. It will be all about his glory. It will be all about the kingdom of God. We have left some for ourselves. We want to be seen. We want people to recognize us. We want to have this bodyguard and this kind of a protocol. And we want to, you know, package ourselves. But that is not what God is looking for. God is looking for men that shall die to themselves, and their lives henceforth, the glory of God will be seen out of their lives. Hallelujah. Amen. That is the kind of a person that God is looking for. He is looking for people that have no names. The only name they shall carry is the name of God. The Bible talks about John, and the Bible says, among the children of men, there is none that rose that was great as John. There is no prophet that rose as great as John. Now, if you read and study the ministry of John, you realize that John did no miracle, not even one. John never did any miracle. John was a prophet, but he never prophesied. The only ministry that he did was just to recognize the Lamb of God. And he told people, behold, the Lamb of God that washes the sins of the world. His work was to point unto Messiah. His work was just to show people the Messiah. And he said, I must decrease that he may increase. That as long as Jesus has appeared now, I don't need to be seen. I do not need to appear anywhere. It is all about him. It is about his kingdom. It is about his power. It is about his authority. John's ministry disappeared when Jesus appeared. And the man did not have a problem with it. As a matter of fact, some of his disciples, when he looked at Jesus and he said, that is the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. The Bible says some of his disciples forsook him. And they went and joined themselves to the disciples of Jesus. He never quarreled with Jesus, telling him, I am your forerunner. I am your father in the Lord. I am your ABCD. No. He saw that his mandate and his assignment on the face of the earth has come to pass. And he has passed on the baton. Hallelujah. Amen. Today, I want to beseech you, according to this scripture, by the mercies of the living God, by the mercies of the living God, let us offer ourselves as a living sacrifice. I read something the other day, and I was so provoked. I wondered, God, what am I doing on the face of the earth? That one of the team, I think they are called the Zizodorf or something, they wanted to preach so much in France, and they could not go to France. They did not have the ability to enter France. So they looked for people that were buying slaves to go to France. And they sold themselves as slaves so that they may get a means to be transported to France to go and preach the gospel. And I asked God, now what kind of a alive are we living on the face of the earth? If somebody can sell himself into slavery so that they may go into a land that they are denied to enter to preach your gospel, then something is wrong with my generation. We are not receiving Christ. We are not believing. We are not dedicating ourselves to God. We have not sacrificed our lives to God. We have never totally surrendered ourselves to God. And then they took the money that they sold and they gave to charity. And they went in that place and they served as slaves. And in the process of serving as slaves, now they were able to preach the gospel in that land. And the power of God was able to move. And the whole land of France was revolutionized because a man offered himself as a living sacrifice. We are living in a generation that people are born again, and your opposite neighbor does not know even whether you are born again. We are living in a generation that every day there are people that you are interacting with, and most of them, maybe they are colleagues or business partners and everyone, and you have worked with them, and now it's up to 5 years, and they have never known that you know Jesus. I read an account of a man called John Gillick. And the time when he was baptized with the Holy Ghost, this thing came on him so heavy. He was doing a business, and in this business, every year he could earn over $50,000. He went to the office. When a client came before he served them, but the Bible says he used to say, by the Spirit of God, he began to scan them and he began to see the problem they were in, and he would begin to minister to them and he would begin to lay hands on them until he forgot whether this man was a client. Everyone that came, he saw them as a potential believer and a potential Christian, and it continued until he went to his boss and he told him, "I want you to relieve me of this job for a short time, because I feel like this thing is so heavy in me. I can never avoid it. I can never stop it. It's just flowing." And the boss, because he was one of the best salesmen that he had, he told him, I'm giving you a 3 months leave. Go and just, you know, have time with God and come back to yourself and rethink about this matter. Reconsider it and then come back after 3 months. And the man said, that day, oh God, the glory of God was manifested. I said bye-bye to be employed by men, and I surrender to the work of the kingdom. That man in a land called Spokane in the U.S., they rated his land as one of the most healthiest cities on the face of the earth. Because the man went, opened what he calls the healing schools and healing houses, and people were brought everywhere to be healed in that place. He trained men on how to heal, and he lived for that assignment. How can we have it, and people that need it cannot see it from us? How can we have Jesus, and people that need Jesus cannot be able to discern if you carry him? Something is wrong. We have not offered ourselves unto the Lord. We are a generation, fukufuku generation, lukewarm generation, a generation that is so divided, and a generation that is mixing everything, that has not understood the way of the cross. The Bible says it is narrow. The Bible says the way of the cross is the way of the sacrifice. The way of the cross is the way of surrender. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Offer your body as a living sacrifice. Offer your body as a living sacrifice. Something must happen in our generation. It must happen. And there must be remnants that the Lord will use. Some of us, even the way we are serving God, is like we are doing him a favor. It is like, God, you are privileged to have me as your servant. That is why you hear people talk about